So before,
if there's ever been a time to make your mind up, it's now, isn't it? We have no idea when Armageddon will break. None of us have. So we want to try and help our student to make as quick a progress as possible and to fall in love with Jehovah, realize he has an organization, and stick to it. And the only way to do that is to help them to appreciate the steps that they need to take. But brothers, I'll say it again, they will not take them automatically. You and I have to isolate them and help them take them one at a time. And then, of course, they'll begin to do what we were developing, you remember, of course, on Thursday night. Do you remember that key text that we had a look at? Let's have a look at it again, please. James chapter 4 and verse 8. It's a lovely verse, isn't it, this James 4:8? Draw close to God, and he will draw close to you. We likened it, if you remember, to like two magnets. When they're properly aligned, they have an attraction for one another, don't they? And the closer the magnets get, the greater the attraction. And physically, if you had magnets strong enough and big enough, then when they came together, it would be physically impossible to separate them. Well, that's the kind of relationship that we must have to survive the battle of Armageddon, mustn't we? We must draw close to God. And it's an interesting thing, too, that verse indicates that it's a reciprocal action. As we make a move towards Jehovah, he makes a move towards us. In a way, he halves the distance. And we indicated, if you remember, from the Apostle Paul's words that he knew that he was close to Jehovah God. It wasn't guessology. He knew. He had an inner feeling, which we all likened it to the conscience. It is the conscience, the ability to have an inner knowledge of ourselves that indicates whether we are close to God or whether we're moving away from him deliberately. What I'd like to do, though, is to appreciate something else we need to do and be ever mindful of if we're going to draw close to God, is to put the spotlight on a very special quality. We must all have it to draw very close to Jehovah. See if you can spot what the quality is. It's drawn to our attention, or the possession of the quality is drawn to our attention in Proverbs 22. And it's verse 4. The result of humility and the fear of Jehovah is riches and glory and life. The quality? Humility. Which is an interesting quality, really, because when you think you've got it, you've lost it. And not true. Do you know the one thing I can boast about is my humility? It's ridiculous, isn't it? No, it's an unusual quality. It is a really, when you get to grips with it and you study the quality out in the Bible, it's an unusual quality. But when you look back at that verse 4, I'm sure you'll agree with me, it's quite obvious, and the rest of the Bible clearly indicates, without it, you cannot get close to God. Because our life is very much dependent on it. One of the great glories that we'll all have at the end of the 1,000 years is the term a son or a daughter of God. At the moment, we're friends. Won't that be lovely? But it all depends, you see, on the amount of attention we give to the quality of humility. But why, I ask myself, is humility such a vital quality to get close to Jehovah God? Why? Well, I think if we open our Bibles to Psalm 18, here we could perhaps, just doing a little thought, a little meditating on the verse, you and I can begin to appreciate why it's such an important quality, why you can't get anywhere near Jehovah without having it to some degree. In fact, when you look at the superscription over the top of the first verse of Psalm 18, brothers, it gives you an indication why David wrote this psalm, doesn't it? The words of this song, he wrote, you notice, in the day that Jehovah had delivered him out of the palm of all his enemies. So David's life had been threatened, or David's life was very much at stake. So part of the psalm, you notice in verse 35, he makes this comment, directing his words now to Jehovah, his sovereign. He says, and you will give me your shield of salvation, which means deliverance of calamity or harm, and your own right hand will sustain me. And your own humility will make me great. So I read that again. And your own humility will make me great. Now that, to me, absolutely blows the mind, doesn't it? that Jehovah, the sovereign of the universe, all knowledge and wisdom rests in him, who is beyond our imagination to comprehend, his majesty, his power, the one who has absolute total authority, has humility. Because I ask myself, what does Jehovah need humility for? We're his slaves, we're his subjects, we're the ones that need it. Why does the Master, why does the Sovereign Lord, Jehovah, need the quality? Because it's obvious he has it. And David recognized that, doesn't he? Because really, who was David? That Jehovah should minister to David and save the man's life. Why, just dust dressed up. Wasn't it? That's all David was. But he'd worked it out in his mind, he thought about it, and under inspiration, correctly, of course, wrote it. Well, I thought, that's lovely, isn't it? That your own humility makes me great. I mean, whose throne did David really sit on? Why, Jehovah's. He was a representative throne of Jehovah's sovereignty over Israel. But what kind of a God is it that will have an imperfect creature represent his sovereignty? Why, a God of humility. Isn't that true? So all I want you to appreciate, brothers, and I'm sure you already do anyway, is that Jehovah has the quality, but I'd like you to just think on how much of the quality he has. Like all the other qualities that Jehovah has, he has it in abundance. Therefore, if you and I are going to get very close to him, we must have it too. But it is a difficult quality to define. It's rather like love. It's ever so difficult to define love. The Apostle Paul never even attempted to. All he did, of course, in his letter to the Corinthians was to concentrate and draw our attention to the actions that the quality prompts. And you find that true with the quality of humility. Let me just demonstrate that to you. In the Hebrew scriptures, right at the top of the whiteboard, there are three words that are used that are translated from the Hebrew into the word humility or humble. But the two there at the top there, Anna and Hithrapis, are the two main two. I just want to concentrate on just for a minute. The first one is Anna, you notice, which means to be humbled. It can also be translated into the English word meekness or even poor. And the other one is Hithrapis, which means to trample on self. So when you look at it like that, it doesn't really help you to appreciate what the quality is. Not really. So let's have a look at some of the actions, the way in which the Bible illuminates the quality and helps us to appreciate what we have got to do to have true humility. I'd like to give you one. It's an interesting messianic prophecy, which in many ways, brothers, set the stage for Jesus' earthly ministry. It's in Zephaniah, and it's chapter 2, and verse 3. Now remember what we've said, this is a prophecy that sets the stage for Jesus Christ's ministry. Zephaniah 2, verse 3. Seek Jehovah, all you meek ones of the earth, who've practiced his own judicial decision. Seek righteousness, seek meekness, and probably you may be concealed in the day of Jehovah's anger. Alright. In the first instance, that would be the anger that came in 70 CE. Now, the interesting thing about it is that the word meekness is translated from that Hebrew word there, Anna. The meek of the earth. And such people resided in the time of Christ in Galilee. They were commonly called the Amiharis, the poor people of the land. And most of them resided in Galilee. By force of circumstances, being poor, being afflicted, it created a state of mind that would more readily accept and respond to the teachings of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's why it's interesting that 11 of the apostles were Galileans, the meek of the earth. Brothers, not the meek of the planet, earthy people, lowly people. Those are the ones that became the nucleus of the Christian organization. But it's difficult to appreciate it without looking at the action. Let me just give you a reason why I say that. Just a little reasoning with you. Proverbs chapter 6. Now, I am not saying that this isn't highlighting true humility, but I'd like you just to reason on it just for a moment. In Proverbs chapter 6, and looking at the first three verses, here's the advice that Jehovah has inspired us to all take if we find ourselves in this kind of a predicament. Verse 1, Proverbs 6. My son, if you have gone surety for your fellow man, or if you've acted as a guarantor, in other words, or if you've given your handshake even to the stranger, if you've been ensnared by the sayings of your mouth, if you've been caught by the sayings of your mouth, take this action then, my son, and deliver yourself, for you have come into the palm of your fellow man. Go humble yourself and storm your fellow man with importunities. Now there's the word. The word humble in that verse 3 is that word there. In the original Greek Hebrew text, hithrapis. But just think about it. This man has got himself in a bit of a mess. So what is the advice is to storm your fellow man with apologies, importunities, and try to get yourself out of the mess that you're in. My argument is, I'm not saying it's not true humility. I'm not saying it's bad advice, because it's very good advice. All I'm saying is, you could, though, would you not agree, show humility to benefit yourself. Like Uriah Heep, you remember him? Dickens' character, your very humble servant, sir. Well, he just demonstrated humility to benefit himself. See, in many ways, if you think of it, you could put on a cloak of humility, couldn't you? A disguise of humility, just to suit ourselves, if we're not careful. Pride can sometimes put on the cloak of humility. Well, I've got to be humble now. I'm an elder. But see, that is not true humility, brothers. I'm sure that the Apostle Paul found that he might have a problem here when he wrote a letter to the Philippians, because there was a problem amongst many of the Christians in Philippi. They had lost all sense of direction when it came to demonstrating humility with one another. And so he wrote them in the letter an interesting phrase, which is called lowliness of mind. There it is. The Greek word you find in Philippians chapter 2 and verse 3 is dapeinophrosyne. And what it really means, it's one word, but I've broken it into two just to help you to appreciate how it forms. Dapeino means to make low. Phrosyne, the mind. Where we get the phrase, of course, lowliness of mind. Now, if that's lowliness of mind, then we're looking at something constant, aren't we? Not something you put on to suit the occasion, but it's constantly with you. It's a state of mind. It's how you see your relationship with Jehovah, or how you see your relationship with your other brothers. And Paul expressed it, didn't he, very nicely, that you should see the others in the congregation as superior to yourself, if you have true humility. It's rather interesting, because Paul must have had a problem with this, because in the Greek language there is no such thing as lowliness of mind. That's the beauty of the Greek language. You can make the words up. See, if you were a Greek and you were expressing, if you were talking about a fellow Greek and you described him as a man that was dapeino, well, that would be a derisory comment, because what you're really saying is a lowly man. And the Greeks would see that as a weakness. But the Apostle Paul was helping his brothers to appreciate, that's not a weakness, that's a strength. Lowliness of mind. That's backbone, not weakness. But can you see the point, brothers? It's something that is constantly with you. See, the word humility itself, of course, it's not an English word at all, is it? It's a Latin word, humilis, which means close to the soil. See, where we have to be in our mind is like a carpet. Where do you put a carpet? On the floor. Now, I'm not suggesting, and the scriptures don't suggest, do they, that we throw away our dignity, throw away our self-respect. Nothing to do with that. It's just how we see ourselves in relationship to others, particularly, of course, Jehovah. And it is hard to imagine that the Sovereign Lord has this kind of a quality and gives us the most outstanding example of it in the Bible. Let me take you to that example. It's in Psalm 113. Let's have a look at verses 5 to 8 of Psalm 113. Interesting question, isn't it, verse 5? Who is like Jehovah our God, him who is making his dwelling on high? He is condescending to look on heaven and earth. Raising up the lowly one from the very dust, he exalts the poor one from the ashpit itself, to make him sit with the nobles of his people. Well, let's just break that down. We're going to look at here the most staggering demonstration of humility. If you look at the first, that first verse we read together, verse 5, an interesting question, isn't it? Who is like Jehovah our God, him who is making his dwelling on high? See, where is Jehovah? See, where does he reside? You find that difficult to comprehend. You might remember that on page 74 of the Revelation Climax book, where comments were made in connection with our understanding of Revelation 4 and verse 1, that Jehovah does not dwell in outer space. So where is he then? His dwelling is far higher than outer space. And that is what is suggested, isn't it? In verse 6, he even condescends to look upon the universe, which is absolutely impossible for you and I to comprehend. All the psalmist is helping us to appreciate in trying to think about the answer to the question is that Jehovah resides in the most majestic place we could possibly imagine. He is the most loftiest and the most beautiful creature in all of the heavens. It is impossible for us to imagine how high Jehovah really is. And yet here, according to the verses, we have one of his servants who's demonstrating his repentance and his turning around by doing what was done in those days, sitting in the ash pit and publicly throwing ashes over himself. How lowly he felt. That's the idea. But the point is, the verse clearly indicates, when you look at verse 7 and 8, that Jehovah comes down from the very highest of the highest to the very lowest point on this planet, the ashpit itself. He ministers to this man, forgives him, lifts him up, so that now with a clear conscience he can go and sit with the nobles of his people again. The point is, brothers, of course, that no one has ever come down that far, have they? No one ever has come down that far. Now that is true humility, isn't it? The action. That's what we're looking at. I can understand why David was indicating that as far as he was concerned, he was his greatest minister. And you and I, of course, if we think about it, brothers, we benefit from the fact that Jehovah has that quality, because he is mankind's greatest benefactor. And who are we? Why, just dust on the scales. A microscopic dot in the Milky Way. Nobody really, are we? Not really. But Jehovah is such a lovely personage. He even put the clothes on Adam and Eve's back after their transgression. It's ever so difficult, wouldn't you agree, for Jehovah to walk with someone who really thinks he's a somebody. Someone who thinks he's really important. Not really. Lack of soundness of mind, isn't it? But what is also interesting is why Jehovah has the quality and why you and I benefit from it. It's a little reasoning on Isaiah 63. And this again is another reason why we should take the quality of humility as an essential in drawing very close to Jehovah. And I think we'll be able to work that out by just doing a little reasoning on a couple of verses from this chapter, which deals with a certain part of Israel's history. Isaiah 63. You'll notice that if you look at verse 8 and 9, where Jehovah's saying now, surely they, that's Israel, are my people, sons that will not prove false. And so it was to them that he came to be a saviour. During all their distress, it was distressing to him. And his own personal messenger saved them. And in his love and in his compassion, he himself repurchased them. And he proceeded to lift them up and carry them all the days of long ago. Who were Israel? Well, just dust on the scales. And yet here we are, we're looking at a situation here where the nation were in desperate distress, in an awful plight. And Jehovah, of course, ministers to them, which obviously takes the quality of humility. But the argument that I'm raising with you, brothers, is for Jehovah to feel the distress that his named people were feeling, what other quality must obviously come along the quality of humility? Go on, Brother Lee. Shout it out. Empathy. Which is the ability, isn't it, to put yourself in somebody else's shoes. What shoes? The shoes of the Israelites. But who were they? Nobody, really. In fact, you get an idea of how distressed Jehovah was when you look at the middle, virtually, of verse 15 of that same chapter, 63 of Isaiah, where it speaks about the commotion of Jehovah's inward parts and mercy. It reminds you of someone else. It does me. The Lord Jesus, moved with pity. Isn't it interesting that? See, that's why, if you think about it, why the quality is so essential for you and I. Jehovah ministers to us, so we benefit from his quality of humility, and he has empathy for us. We saw that beautifully expressed for us in that recent watchtower, how he sifts through, and all the bad drops through the net, as it were, and they're just left with the good, and he concentrates on the good. How kind that is. So he takes the formation of us into account. If we haven't got the quality of humility, it's ever so difficult, brothers, for you and I to develop the quality of empathy. And if we haven't got those two qualities, it is very, very difficult for us to minister fully to people in the territory. We will not see their plight. The seriousness of the fact that they will soon lose their lives if they don't respond and repent is lost. So it affects the amount of time that we spend in the ministry. It affects the amount of time that we perhaps, and the effort that we put into preparing for the ministry. It affects the time and the effort that we put into doing all of our return visit, wherever some soul has shown even the slightest bit of interest. It affects all of those things. That's why this side of Armageddon, it's ever so good for us to appreciate the importance of humility and empathy. It's very difficult for Jehovah to draw close to us when we deliberately don't try to develop the qualities. Let me just take your minds back, if I may, to that letter that Paul wrote to the Philippians, where there were some problems amongst the brothers there. In fact, let's just go to the letter. And the Apostle Paul counsels the brothers there to have lowliness of mind. Well, we've already touched on that, and you can see that quite clearly, can't you, if you have a look at verse 3 of chapter 2. Do nothing out of contentiousness or egotism, you know, competing with your brothers, trying to force your brother to a showdown, forcing him into a corner where he's got a safe face. Doing none of those things, he says, do none of those things, but with lowliness of mind, consider that the other superior to yourself. So he's concentrating on the quality. And you and I have been able to appreciate it's ever so difficult to express the quality in words, to describe it. All you can do is to concentrate on the action. And Paul obviously found that was true with himself. So what he does, you'll notice, he concentrates on the Lord Jesus Christ and the actions that demonstrated that he had the quality. Because you notice in verse 5, he says, keep this mental attitude in you that was also in Christ Jesus. Now he begins his reasoning on how the action shows up the quality, lowliness of mind. Let's take these actions and let's look at them closely. Look at verse 6. Talking about Jesus' pre-human existence there, brothers, he talks about him, although he was existing in God's form. Yeah, he was a spirit, wasn't he? But what else did Jesus Christ enjoy in heaven prior to coming down to this earth as a spirit creature, mighty as he was? Can you think of any position that he held, any rank in heaven? Paul's concentrating on this, as we shall see in a moment. Go on, Sister Elizabeth. He was the Word, that's interesting, yes. He was the Logos, or the spokesman of God, yeah. Jehovah spoke through his Son. Marvellous privilege that, eh? Brother Sandy? Yes, a master worker. Yes, not a co-creator, but he was indeed a master worker. brought everything into existence, the universe and all the other intelligent creatures of God, all brought into existence through Christ Jesus being the master worker. Please, Brother Ali.
The relationship we have with the
Father and the Holy Spirit,
as my son,
I love it. Yes, it's the greatest love story that could have ever been written, because it's very difficult for us to comprehend the kind of emotions and relationship that Jesus and Jehovah had. No novelist could write a love story so great. What else did he enjoy in his relationship with Jehovah? Go on, sister. Yes, he was. Quite right. Yes, he was the archangel. Yes, not an archangel, but the archangel. Sister Anne? Yes, now that's an interesting one, isn't it? The monogenes. It's the Greek term, isn't it? A one-off. Like monocups. You've seen these plastic polystyrene cups. They're one-off. You use them, don't you? Drink out of them. And when you finish, you throw them away. They're one-off. Monocups. Jesus Christ was absolutely unique. He was an absolute one-off. Why? What made him unique compared with the rest of the invisible heavens? What, Brother Lee? Yes, indeed. Absolute direct creation by God, and if anybody could reflect the qualities of God, no one as near as Jesus. No one. That's why Jesus could say, when he came to the earth, still in the capacity as the Word, wasn't he? John 1 verse 14 states that. But he said, no, anyone, of course, if you see me, you've seen the Father. So that's the kind of relationship, those are the kind of positions or rank that Jesus had prior to coming to this earth. But notice Paul's reasoning, brothers. Now when you look down at verse 7, he says, but he emptied himself and took a slave's form and came to be in the likeness of man. What did he mean when he said that? He emptied himself. Emptied himself of what? Brother Sandy? Yes, absolutely. He divested himself of all the privileges that he had in heaven. And interestingly too, if you think about it, brothers, he, more than that, was prepared to have his existence in heaven be terminated. Never thought of that. In fact, he lost all consciousness of his relationship with his Father, that he even had a pre-human existence, right up until his baptism. For 30 years, he lost it all. Jehovah knew that that would happen. You go to the tap and you have a glass of water. Oh, that's lovely. And you wash the glass out and you tip it upside down and you put it on the drainer to drain. And as far as you're concerned, there's nothing in it. It's been emptied. But you leave it there and you can come back 15 to 20 minutes and you can lift the glass up and there's a ring of water there. It's not been totally emptied. The last dregs of it are now out of it. And that's the idea. Jesus absolutely, totally emptied himself of everything. He came down to the earth to be a man of no reputation. Because who was he really? A carpenter's son. A tradesman. A Galilean. They were called, of course, by, I suppose, today's terms, the country bumpkins of Israel. All that Paul is doing is concentrating on the action to help his brothers in Philippi to appreciate, if you want to get close to God, if you want to get glory in life, this is the quality that you're looking for, lowliness of mind. I think it's interesting too when you think about it, that when Jehovah transferred the life of his son to impregnate an egg in Mary's womb, how big was Jesus at the moment of conception? Alec?
Microscopic.
Of course he didn't know that, did he? Jehovah hid all that from him because it would be too upsetting. Of course he didn't. Jesus was in on the creation, wasn't he? He knew what he was going to have to do. How big he would become. And then to be pushed around as a baby. How would you feel if somebody dressed you up as a baby and pushed you around in a baby? Popped a dummy in your mouth? You see, all I'm saying to you, brothers, would you volunteer to do it? To minister to the needs of others? Jesus did. You know what it tells me? It tells me a lot about Jesus Christ, that he refused to use what he already had in heaven to his own advantage. That's what it tells me. He was not and is not an ambitious position seeker in God's organization. It's lovely, isn't it, when you look at the quality. I want you to get at that thought there in that verse 7. Nobody took a slave's form. What do you think of that? What's Paul really saying that there in that verse, in that phrase? He took a slave's form. Well, keep your finger in Philippians, chapter 2. But have a look at Isaiah 53 with me, because this is a prophecy about Jesus, isn't it? That was, of course, fulfilled many years afterwards. A messianic prophecy. Isaiah 53. And please look with me, brothers, at verse 3. Here he's talking about Jesus, even before he came down to this earth, of course. He was despised and was avoided by men. A man meant for pains and for having acquaintance with sickness. And there was if the concealing of one's face from us. He was despised, and we held him of no account. Jesus knew that that prophecy had been written about him. Why? Because he was the Word of God. He was instrumental in having it inspired and written. Isn't it fantastic when you look at the quality? What we're looking at really is a king that exchanges his robes for sackcloth of voluntary humiliation to serve the needs of mankind. It's lovely, isn't it? And I thought it's rather interesting how the Apostle Paul, as though he hasn't finished yet, because if you look down at verse 8, it's as though he wants to take it on a little bit further just to make sure his brothers really get the message. When he says, now, but even more than that, when he found himself in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient as far as death. And then he says, yes, as though it's an exclamation. Yes, death on a torture stake. See, if you think about that, it's rather interesting, brothers, the way that Jesus died, because justice did not demand that Jesus die on a torture stake. So why did he die on a torture stake then? Brother Lee. To take the curse off the nation. Yes, you're quite right. To give the Jews an equal opportunity, the same as everybody else, to become the bride of Christ. Marvellous, isn't it? I remember some years ago reading an article in the Lancet Journal, which is the journal that is written by the British Medical Association. And it was dealing with the scientific evidence that Jesus' death was exactly as recorded in the Gospels, that is accurate and scientific. And I remember the last couple of paragraphs made some very interesting reading and very, well, it tug at your heartstrings, really. One of the points that it did make, but it would be the most agonizing form of dying you could possibly ever imagine, dying on a torture stake. And Paul wanted the brothers to appreciate that, because the reason why Jesus died that way was because he had the quality of humility. However, there was one thing he found ever so difficult to cope with. You remember, with strong outcries and pains, he petitioned Jehovah God to save him, not from death, but from what? What did Jesus find so difficult to cope with in his execution? Can you remember? Please, brother. Yes, because he died as a what? Please. Yes, he did, that is true, but particularly as, brother? He was, yes. Go on, Anne. Yes, as a blasphemer. I mean, imagine that. Jehovah's champion dying as a blasphemer. Oh, he found that ever so difficult to cope with. Because he loved the Father so much. Oh, he did find that difficult to cope with. And you know, if anything, more than the pain on the torture stake, that he was going to pull through that, he needed Jehovah's help. And that's why he went to the Father with strong outcries and tears to help him to cope with that. How could I ever die this way? You know me, you know how much I love you. He found it ever so difficult. But he came through it, and he coped with it, because he had the quality. And that's why Paul makes this point. What we read in verse 4, in verse Proverbs 22, it means glory, and it means life. Because what does it say in verse 9? For this very reason, God exalted him to a superior position. For what very reason? Because Jesus Christ proved his humility beyond any doubt whatsoever. What exalted position does Jesus now occupy, brothers? Go on, sister.
Yeah, well, he was sat there, actually, sister, wasn't he, until 1914. It's quite true. So he did have that position. Please, brother. Yes, indeed, that is true. But it's even higher than that, you know, really. Go on, Brother Lee. Well, that is true, yes. It's even higher than that. Go on, Sister June. All right, yeah, it's even higher than that. Go on, Brother. Yes, you're quite right. He is. He's all of those things, Brother Sandy. You're quite right, yes. Do you know it's even higher than that? I wonder if you've ever thought of it this way. Look down, please, with me at verse 11. That every tongue should openly acknowledge that Jesus Christ is what? Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Now, in that expression there, what it really means is that Jesus Christ is in charge of God's glory. So everything that is accomplished in heaven, the gathering together, remember that's what's spoken of in Ephesians 1, isn't it? Of all the things into heaven, into the Christ, and all the things on the earth, into the Christ. All those things that Jesus Christ's ministration will bring about, this administration, this all-embracive thing that enables everyone to recognize and appreciate Jehovah's sovereignty, will all be brought about through Jesus Christ as the Messianic King and the millennial reign of the Lord Jesus Christ. And absolutely everything he does, he will make sure goes to the glory of the Father. He will not attach anything to himself. Why not? Because he's a dapper, you know. Person, because he's lowly. Are you like that, brothers? I know I've got a lot to work on to be like that, haven't you? And I can understand, you know, when James, when he wrote that little section of his letter in chapter 4 about drawing close to God, he concentrated on this quality. Because you notice that if you look at verse 6 of James chapter 4, James 4 and verse 6, halfway through, he says, God opposes the haughty ones, but he gives undeserved kindness to the humble ones. And then in verse 8, draw close to God, and he will draw close to you. And of course we will, and we'll have a knowledge of how close we are, and how much we have to develop the quality, as we develop, of course, the conscience as well. And I'm sure that you'll be out with all your humility and all your conscience tomorrow. If I could just remind you where we're meeting tomorrow at 9:15, 13 Rimmon Crescent, both in the morning and in the afternoon at 1:15. We'll be delighted to have your company. And I'd like to just specially emphasize Friday, because we don't always find that Friday is the best supported morning or afternoon. But as I said to you on Tuesday, if you remember, this is the way that Sister Armstrong and I get our encouragement to stay on the road, is the support that you, dear brothers, give us. If you don't give us the support, we get discouraged. You might not think that we do, but we do, brothers. So if you can even only spend us or give us half an hour of your time in the morning, we'd be delighted to have your company. So please be with us. 9:15, 13 Rimmon Crescent. And then 9:30 on Saturday, here at the Kingdom Hall, we'll be meeting for field service activity.
new world, who will qualify to enter? Let's give our attention to Brother Mark Hendricks, our circuit overseer. Al-Haji became a soldier against his will. It wasn't what he wanted to do, but as the troops came and destroyed the village that he lived in, they forcefully enlisted Al-Haji. In the days that followed, they transformed this once innocent person into a heartless killer. He was given his own AK-47. He went on food raids. He burned down houses. He killed and he mutilated. How old do you think Al-Haji was? He was just 10. 10 years old. In fact, more than 300,000 soldiers around the earth today are mere children. 9, 10, 11-year-olds. They are involved in countless conflicts that plague this planet each and every day of our lives. Conflicts that are going on right now as we give this talk. See, here, living in such a peaceful place like Hawaii, people come from all over to actually get away, be part of the paradise. We can hardly imagine, in fact, to some of us, it's impossible to imagine, that all over the earth right now, millions of people are suffering. They're living joyless lives. Lives that are filled with unspeakable horror. Just think of what's happening right now in a place called Darfur. Many have not even heard of a place called Darfur. And yet the United Nations has called it the greatest crisis in the world. The United States has called it genocide. It's happening right now as we give this talk. Some 180,000 people have already perished. They've been mutilated. Men, women, and children. Some 2 million are on the run. It's a government-backed campaign to eliminate an entire race of mankind. It's happening as we speak. Although we don't see things like this happening in this part of the world yet, imagine if we were transported there instantly. Imagine if our assignment for the remainder of this system was to live there, live out the remaining days in this system, in a place like Darfur or Iraq. How would we feel? How would we feel knowing that perhaps our spouse, our husband, or wife may not come home today? Or if we're a parent, how would we feel if we had to think about our children not being around by the end of the day? That's a real possibility. That is happening right now all over the earth. What do you think these people are thinking right at this moment? Maybe the words of Job. You look at Job chapter 14. Perhaps they can relate to these comments by Job, in Job chapter 14. And we know Job, he went through a terrible time. He went from a beautiful life to a life that was filled with tragedy. And notice what he says in Job chapter 14, verse 1. He says, "Man born of woman is short-lived and glutted with agitation." Yes, for countless millions, when you read that scripture, they can relate to it. Their lives are glutted with agitation. Many are short-lived. A letter was received by the South African branch of Jehovah's Witnesses. It was from a desperate man, and this is what he said. He says, "I'm unemployed. I steal in the city whenever there's a chance. If I don't, we are hungry for days. There's absolutely no work. Many are roaming the streets in search of work and something to eat. I know of others who search the dustbins for food. Some commit suicide. Many like me are depressed and hopeless. It seems like there's no hope for the future. Does God, who created us with the need to eat and clothe ourselves, not see this?" Yes, this man was alive, true. But his life was truly glutted with agitation. And no doubt it was short-lived. He even wondered if there was a God. Throughout the earth, more and more people, they face hardship, insecurity, fear. Like this man, they live joyless lives. They just exist, don't they? And even here, in this part of the earth, you wouldn't have to walk very far in this kingdom hall. And you'd have to meet people who are suffering with drug addiction, depression, hopelessness, broken families, health crises. The list goes on and on. Many find it so bad they'd rather not be alive. In this community, people might even feel afraid of leaving their own homes. In New York and other cities around the earth, people feel frightened. They wonder if they're going to come home the next day because they feel that perhaps there will be some terrorist attack that will take place. Places like Los Angeles and New York, it's not a matter of if, it's a matter of when and where things will take place. Now you and I, we live on this planet, we see the things happening, don't we? We open a newspaper, we turn on the news, and we see tragedy each and every day. And sometimes we even become desensitized to it because it doesn't touch us personally. But it's happening, and we want it to stop, don't we? Are we ready for a change? Well, many feel that the changes that we need can come from this world's governments. But over the thousands of years that this world's governments have ruled, what has it proven? What has their track record been? Notice the words of wise King Solomon at Ecclesiastes chapter 8. And see if you don't agree with his observation concerning man and the governments in this system. That's Ecclesiastes chapter 8 and verse 9. Says in verse 9, all this I have seen, and there was an applying of my heart to every work that has been done under the sun during the time that man has dominated man to his injury. Yes, wise King Solomon recognized that man only makes matters worse for humans. Human rulers, although they might have good intentions, all have one quality in common. Called sin, imperfection. And so very often they will say or do anything, even lie outright, just to gain the support of people. Take, for example, this country. Remember back in the 1980s, if you were alive back then, some of you weren't, but remember back then, the then president, he said something very confidently. He said, "Read my lips, no new taxes." Of course, we know what happened, right? And then the next president, remember what he said? There was a scandal between him and another younger woman, and he went in front of all the millions of viewers, and he wagged his finger, and he says, "I did not commit sexual relations with that woman." Of course, we later found out what he did do. And even this government, in a speech that the vice president made on August 26, 2002, he was quoted as saying this, "Simply stated, there is no doubt that Saddam Hussein now has weapons of mass destruction." And with this statement, and others by high officials in the government, this country, as well as other countries, were catapulted into war with that nation. And even after many years of fighting, not a single weapon of mass destruction was ever found. And yet the fighting rages on, doesn't it? Thousands have lost their life. People who live there, what are their lives like now? That was their home. And yet innocent people, thousands of them, have been mercilessly killed. So when we consider the failure of government, the dishonesty, the scandal, the cover-ups, could we ever really put our trust in this world's leaders? Would you? Notice though what Jehovah tells us to do in Proverbs chapter 3. Even in light of all the government's failures, Jehovah tells us to do something when it comes to him. Proverbs chapter 3, and notice what he tells us in verse 5 and 6. It says, "Trust in Jehovah with all your heart, and do not lean upon your own understanding. In all your ways, take notice of him, and he himself will make your path straight. Jehovah is telling us, just like a loving father, that you might not be able to trust any human ruler, but you can trust me. In fact, you can trust me with all your heart, Jehovah tells us. And if we do that, he promises us that our life will be better. Our paths will be straight. Do you trust Jehovah? Now, this might be very difficult for us, because especially when it comes to those in positions of high authority, we just assume that they will say things just to get our approval. Campaign promises, we know that they'll never come true, so we just don't believe. It's almost as if around the earth, and maybe even in our congregation, we can begin to let a callus go around our heart. Do you know what a callus is? It's something that forms on a hand or on a foot after constantly being rubbed. That thick piece of skin is actually a protection to us, protects the rest of our foot. That's why people can walk on these sharp objects and not have anything happen to them. It's a callus. But there's one problem with a callus. You can't feel anything. I remember a plumber that I knew for many years, been doing it for about 30 years, and he had hands that were so calloused they didn't even look like hands anymore. In fact, he told me an experience one time where he was working and there was an open flame and he had his hand, it was on the open flame over it. He had been looking somewhere else. He didn't even realize it till he started to feel or smell the flesh start to burn. Imagine that. His hands were calloused. And that's what can happen to our hearts. After constantly being rubbed and being discouraged, being let down, we don't have any more feeling. When we hear promises from God's Word, the Bible, when someone tells us to trust them, we don't listen. We don't believe. We put up this protective thing around our heart. But Jehovah tells us to trust Him because He is different. What makes Jehovah so different from every other human ruler? Notice at Hebrews chapter 6 and verse 17. Hebrews chapter 6. The Apostle Paul helps us to appreciate that Jehovah has a quality that every human ruler does not have. Hebrews chapter 6, starting in verse 17. Says, in this manner God, when he purposed to demonstrate more abundantly to the heirs of the promise the unchangeableness of his counsel, stepped in with an oath, in order that although through two unchangeable things, in which it is impossible for God to lie, we who have fled to the refuge may have strong encouragement to lay hold on the hope set before us. It's impossible for God to lie, the Apostle Paul says. Now that truly is a profound statement, because how long has Jehovah been alive? He has no beginning. He will have no end. And in all that time, he has not lied one single time. That's an amazing thing. Now what human ruler could ever say that? It's almost like it's impossible for them not to lie when it comes to campaign promises and other things. Now with this in mind, with this fact in mind, we have to look at the promise that Jehovah made to us at 2 Peter, a few pages over, 2 Peter chapter 3 and verse 13. The Apostle Peter helps us to see that Jehovah has told us what will happen in our future. It says in verse 13, but there are new heavens and a new earth that we are awaiting according to his promise. And in these righteousness is to dwell. Now we just learned that Jehovah, it's impossible for him to lie. He has made a promise to us. Now Jehovah will keep his word, even if it hurts him. We think about men, when they figure out that maybe they said something that's going to cause them pain, what do they do normally? They go back on their word, don't they? They may try to shift the responsibility to someone else, but not Jehovah. We're going to look at two examples of how we know that Jehovah will keep his word, even if it causes him great pain. The first one is in Genesis chapter 2 and verse 16. Yes, Jehovah is a God of truthfulness. And as we go to Genesis chapter 2 verse 16, we'll see a test of Jehovah's truthfulness here. Genesis chapter 2 and verse 16. It says, "And Jehovah God also laid this command upon the man. From every tree of the garden you may eat to satisfaction. But as for the tree of the knowledge of good and bad, you must not eat from it. For in the day you eat from it, you will positively die." That was a very clear promise. If those two first humans, in particular Adam, ate from that tree, Jehovah said he would die. Very clear. But do you think that Jehovah, when he spoke these words to Adam, actually thought that Adam would actually go ahead and eat that fruit? Incomprehensible to Jehovah that his first creation, human creation, would actually eat that fruit. In fact, Jehovah gave Adam and Eve everything to make their life perfect. They had a perfect home. They had every tree of the garden to eat from. They had everything that would make them happy. It's almost like saying to someone, "Here, I'm going to give you this mansion, and then I'm going to give you a free pass to Costco, and you can buy anything you'd like forever. Doesn't matter what. Just have as much as you want. Just keep going." Wow, that would be nice, right? And maybe that person that says this to us, he just says, "You see this can of green beans? I'm going to put it right in the middle of Costco, and I just don't want you to have that. Don't even touch it." Now, you might think, "I don't even like canned green beans. That's not much of a test for me." But that's how easy it was for Adam and Eve to obey. They had everything. Just one single tree they could not eat from. But they did. And now came a true test of Jehovah's honesty. Would he allow his first two human children to wither away and die? Just think of it. I'm not a father, but I know that there are many fathers here. And when you have your firstborn children, your firstborn son or daughter, I can see the pride that comes from the faces of those fathers. And this was Jehovah's first two children, newborns to him. He loved them. He didn't want to see them get hurt. He would do anything to make sure that their life was going to be perfect. So now, what was he going to do? Think about how old Eve was. How old do you think Eve was? Some say 50, 60. Well, what was the first command that Adam and Eve got collectively? Fill the earth and subdue it. Now, if you were Adam and you had a perfect, most beautiful wife, and you were given that command by Jehovah, fill the earth and subdue it, be fruitful, you would work on that project right away. Right? But you see, when Adam and Eve, they sinned, Eve sinned, she was not even pregnant, was she? So that could mean that Eve could have only been days old. She was a newborn to Jehovah. Would Jehovah watch as his two first children withered away and died? It was a painful thing. But Jehovah uttered a command and a promise, and he would not go back on his word. Jehovah is a God of truthfulness. A second example of this is John chapter 3 and verse 16. And no doubt we know this scripture already. John chapter 3 and verse 16. Jesus says, "For God loved the world so much that he gave his only begotten Son, in order that everyone exercising faith in him might not be destroyed, but have everlasting life." Now, when Jesus spoke these words, there was plenty of time for Jehovah to look down on Jesus' pitiful condition on this earth and to rescue him. That was, of course, his firstborn creation. Would he allow Jesus to go through all the torment, all the suffering, or would he rescue his son and go back on his word? Well, think about the fact that Jesus, in order for him to be a ransom for us, all he needed to do was die. Now, that's a big price to pay. But he could have died like his friend John the Baptizer. John the Baptizer was beheaded. It was quick. But Jesus, Satan had in store for Jesus the most terrible death possible. 3 hours of torment. Now, when Jehovah finally recognized that Jesus was going to suffer, for 3 hours, bleed to death. How difficult do you think it was for Jehovah not to want to rescue his son, go back on his word? Do you think it was painful for Jehovah? Well, let's just look at Luke chapter 23 and see how painful it must have been for Jehovah. Luke chapter 23 and verse 44. Luke chapter 23 verse 44, it says, "Well, by now it was about the sixth hour, and yet a darkness fell all over the earth, all the earth until the ninth hour." Now this was the time that Jesus was on that stake. This was at 12 o'clock in the afternoon to 3 o'clock. And did you notice what happened all over the earth? A darkness fell over it. It's almost as if Jehovah couldn't bear to watch. He turned out the lights. It must have been so painful for Jehovah to see his son mercilessly killed. Was it difficult for Jehovah? Could he have gone back on his word? Absolutely. Could he have changed the laws? He was the creator of the laws. But isn't it beautiful to think that Jehovah, even out of convenience to himself, does not change his laws, the laws that he's created? With man, it's different. They try to find loopholes with laws. They try to go around laws. If they don't find any loopholes, if they can't change the law, they just break the law. Jehovah is a God of truthfulness. He doesn't change laws to accommodate himself, and that's why we can trust him. So in light of these two things and many others, we can see how Jehovah, through great pain and sacrifice to himself, has always kept his word. He's always been a God of truthfulness. Do we have any reason not to trust Jehovah? Absolutely not. Right now, we can think back all the way to the Garden of Eden, and we can see how Jehovah has taken action right from the beginning to make things right for us. Don't you think it would have been easier for Jehovah to just have eliminated Adam and Eve when they first sinned and start from scratch? But think about, Jehovah looked at the unborn children in Adam and Eve and the possibility that he had. He could envision us, you and I. Because if he would have eliminated Adam and Eve, we would not be here today. Maybe there would be less problems, but we would not be here. And so right from the beginning, in Genesis chapter 3, verse 15, Jehovah uttered the first prophecy. There would be a seed that would come, and that would redeem mankind, the human race. And we know who that seed is, right? It was his firstborn son, Jesus. Jesus became the father to us that Adam never was. In fact, Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6, it calls Jesus what? Our eternal father. He's earned the right to have that title. Because just like as if we were orphans, and in a sense, you and I actually are, because we've lost our first parents, haven't we? They've abandoned us. They've died. They left us on our own. We're orphans. And so Jesus came to reclaim us, just like a wonderful father. And he paid a very high price. He paid with his life. And that's why he can be called our eternal father. But now we have hope. In fact, Bible prophecy reveals that since 1914, this Jesus, our father, we can say he has been ruling in kingdom power with 144,000. Jehovah has allowed him to rule in his kingdom. And during these last few decades, he has been making the final preparations to take over rulership of this earth. Like the text for this year indicates, the great day of Jehovah is near. It's close. In fact, very soon we can say the great day of Jehovah will be here. So we're looking for that. Notice what will happen very soon in Daniel chapter 2 and verse 44. Daniel chapter 2, he sees a vision of all these different kingdoms, kingdom powers. And at the very end, he sees in verse 44 what will happen at the end of this system. It says, "And in the days of those kings, the God of heaven will set up a kingdom that will never be brought to ruin." That has happened. That's history. It happened in 1914. Notice what this kingdom will very shortly do. It says, "And the kingdom itself will not be passed on to any other people. It will crush and put an end to all these kingdoms, and it itself will stand to times indefinite. Yes, Jesus, as the king of that kingdom, is now ruling in kingdom power in heaven, and he is ready to take over rulership of this earth. Yes, all of earth's inhabitants very shortly will have to submit to Jesus' righteous rule. Our eternal Father will finally lead us to the waters of life, eternal life. Now, in 236 lands around the earth, there are over 6.5 million people who have already pledged allegiance to that kingdom. They've already pledged their loyalty. They've already submitted. The question is, have we? Have we pledged allegiance to that kingdom? Have we pledged our loyalty to it? Just like any kingdom, this kingdom has requirements. We need to qualify to be part of it. Even though we are going to be here on the earth, we're not going to be part of that literal kingdom in heaven. We still need to qualify for that kingdom. Isaiah tells us what it will take for us to qualify in Isaiah chapter 35 and verse 8. Notice what he says. Isaiah chapter 35 and verse 8. Notice how he relates the way we need to be in order to qualify for that kingdom. In Isaiah 35 verse 8, it says this. And there will certainly come to be a highway there, even a way, and the way of holiness it will be called. The unclean one will not pass over it, and it will be for the one walking on the way, and no foolish ones will wander about on it. Isaiah, he relates this way to a highway, the way to God's kingdom. Now, if we think about a literal highway, if we want to find a literal highway, what would we do? Would we just start driving around, hoping that we'd run into it one day? Well, maybe that's what some of us do when we're lost. That's what I did yesterday on the way to the Pioneer meeting. And, you know, if you don't have enough humility to say, I'm lost, help me, let me find my way, then you're going to get more lost, more frustrated, right? Until somebody actually asks for directions, like my wife did. That's a good thing we have a wife. But the thing is that many people today, they're driving around aimlessly, aren't they? They're searching for their spirituality. They're hoping that they're going to run into it one day. The highway to holiness. The sad part is most never find it. Most never do. They consistently just wander because they're not using the roadmap, which is God's word. One of the first qualifications that Jehovah's Witnesses all throughout the earth, right from the very beginning, have always adhered to is the qualification of being peaceable. In fact, in Micah, chapter 4, verse 3, this is a very, very important qualification if we're going to be part of that kingdom, that new world that's soon to come. It's Micah chapter 4 and verse 3. You notice what it will take. It says, Micah 4, verse 3, and he will certainly render judgment among many peoples, and set matters straight respecting mighty nations far away. And they will have to beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning shears. They will not lift up sword nation against nation, neither will they learn war anymore. Now this scripture actually sits right in front of the United Nations building, but what a mockery, because the United Nations actually has their own army, and they have this scripture there prominently placed right in front of that building. But to Jehovah's Witnesses, this is a reality. In fact, Jehovah's Witnesses throughout the earth would rather face persecution, imprisonment, death, before they would participate in any wars of this world. Many might call this unpatriotic. You don't love your country. But the question that we need to ask is, if we're involved in a war and a brother on the other side, just because he's of another race, also is involved in that war, and we happen to kill that brother, who will Jehovah view as being innocent? And who will Jehovah view as being guilty? Whose side will Jehovah be on? When Jesus was on the earth, one of the last lessons he taught, in fact, to his disciples, Matthew chapter 26. Remember the Apostle Peter? He took out the sword and he took the ear off of the high priest's slave. Jesus said, return your sword to its place. Those who live by the sword will perish by it. That was a powerful lesson. And so no matter where you go on this planet, you will never see one of Jehovah's Witnesses involved in any type of military activity. Never. Now some might still say you have to obey your country. Well, that might be the excuse that many used to join the Nazi army back in the days of Hitler. Many use that excuse. In fact, the current Pope of the Catholic Church, did you know that Pope Benedict XVI, he was actually a member of Hitler's youth army? Did you know that? Later on, he was enrolled in an anti-aircraft unit. He protected factories making aircraft engines. He watched as these factory workers, who were actually concentration camp slaves, came in and worked. He protected those factories. The Pope says he never took part in any combat or fired a shot, yet he was in Hungary, and he set up tank traps, and he saw Jews being herded to death camps. He was quoted as saying this, "There was no way we could have resisted." His brother, who also joined, said, "Resistance was truly impossible." Tell that to the thousands of Jehovah's Witnesses who went to these concentration camps, German Jehovah's Witnesses, because they did not want to join Hitler's army. They were persecuted and they were executed, but they proved one thing: resistance was possible. One observer said that Jehovah's Witnesses became the example for others. Just imagine if everyone back at that time looked at these things like Jehovah's Witnesses, took the stand of Jehovah's Witnesses. Millions upon millions of innocent people would not have lost their lives. So if we're to qualify to be part of Jehovah's kingdom, part of that new world, even in the face of severe persecution or death, we need to be peaceable. We need to be neutral when it comes to the conflicts of this planet, or else we will disqualify ourselves. Now, the next thing we need to do is to be morally different. This is the next qualification in Ephesians chapter 5. First qualification is to be peaceable. Second is to be morally different from the rest of this world. Ephesians chapter 5. And starting in verse number 3, it says, "Let fornication and uncleanness of every sort or greediness not even be mentioned among you, just as it befits holy people, neither shameful conduct, nor foolish talking, nor obscene jesting, things which are not becoming, but rather the giving of thanks. For you know this, recognizing it for yourselves, that no fornicator, or unclean person, or greedy person," which means being an idolater, "has any inheritance in the kingdom of the Christ and of God." You see the qualifications there? Now the standards of this world continue to fall, don't they? Sex before marriage, sex outside of marriage, sex with the same sex. All these things have become acceptable in this system, haven't they? But you see very clearly in verse 5 that if we engage in a practice of these things, we will disqualify ourselves from being part of God's new world. How sad. We would want to actually disqualify ourselves for doing something so temporary, the temporary enjoyment of sin. The third qualification is found in John chapter 13. So please turn with me there. John chapter 13. Jesus told us exactly how we needed to behave as his witnesses, as his disciples. And in John chapter 13 and verse 34, he gives us a new command, he says. "I'm giving you a new commandment, that you love one another just as I have loved you, that you also love one another. By this all will know that you are my disciples, if you have love among yourselves." Jesus says that love would be the identifying mark of a true Christian. Do we have love among ourselves? The evidence shows that no matter where you go on this planet, you will see the love of Jehovah's Witnesses. No matter what congregation you may attend, you can just about count on it that that brother or that sister would give his own life for you. That's love, just like Jesus. Yes, there are over 6 million individuals who are adhering to this qualification. Are you among them? No doubt the reason why you're here today is because someone came to your door and witness to you about the precious hope that we have. But as we mentioned on Thursday night, the choice has to be ours individually. No one else can make that choice for us. We've got to make that choice for ourselves, and it won't be easy. because Jesus said that the last days of this system would be like the last days of the system back in Noah's day. What were they doing back then? Well, Noah preached for 40 years, didn't he? He went from door to door, perhaps. He went from around at least where he lived, and he talked to people about what was going to happen soon. All the people had to do to gain salvation, to qualify for salvation, was to get inside the ark. It didn't seem like a very difficult task, did it? How many people actually went inside the ark? Only 8. Jesus said that the last days would be just like the days of Noah. Notice how Jesus describes this in Matthew chapter 24. Matthew chapter 24. And notice in verse 37 what he says. He says, "For just as the days of Noah were, so the presence of the Son of Man will be. For as they were in those days before the flood, eating and drinking, men marrying and women being given in marriage until the day that Noah entered into the ark, and they took no note until the flood came and swept them all away, so the presence of the Son of Man will be." Jesus said that the last days would be just like the days of Noah. Were they doing anything wrong? Just looks like they were eating and drinking, marrying. Didn't seem like anything wrong with that. But they took no note. They just led normal lives. But there's a key word there in verse number 39. Did you know what it is? It's the word until. They took no note until the flood came. Maybe for those 40 years they may have mocked Noah. "Look at that crazy man. Wow, he's building that big, gigantic building. He's preaching about a flood. We don't even know what rain is. I can't believe this guy. He's crazy." They took no note until, though, that first raindrop. Imagine walking down the street, not being in the ark, and then feeling the first raindrop of your life hit your head. What do you think those people were thinking at that point? "I should have listened to Noah." Maybe they ran back to the ark. Maybe they began banging on the door. "Noah, let me in, please. I believe you now." Maybe the water started to get up to their thighs and they started to really bang. "Please, Noah, let me in." Why do you think Noah never opened the door? Maybe he looked out from the ark, maybe from one of those high windows that were on the ark, and he saw people that he knew. Maybe his own family, maybe his brothers or sisters or nephews. Maybe he heard voices that sounded familiar. Why didn't he open the door? Notice Genesis chapter 7 and verse 16. This is an important thing to remember about what's going to happen at the end of this system of things as well. Genesis chapter 7 and verse 16. It says, "And those going in, male and female, of every sort of flesh, went in, just as God had commanded him." And this is the point. "After that, Jehovah shut the door behind him." Jehovah shut the door. So maybe Noah wanted to open the door, but he couldn't. Jehovah shut it. The opportunity for salvation for those people was over. It was finished. It was gone. Now today we have a similar ark, don't we? It's called the congregation. Yes, it's here that we will be protected from Jehovah's coming judgment. The question we need to ask is, are we really inside the congregation? Are we inside Jehovah's modern day ark? Jehovah is telling us time is running out. We need to be inside the congregation. Now the Bible doesn't tell us, but maybe over those 40 years that Noah was building that ark, he actually gained some support. Maybe some of the people, for a time, they actually helped him build the ark. Who knows? The Bible doesn't tell us. But it's possible, 40 years. But obviously, they must have gone back to their old lifestyle. They got distracted. They left Noah. But can you imagine having a share in building that ark, maybe even seeing the section of the ark that they built, and not being inside of it when that rain started? But that's what many do today, don't they? Many have been building their ark for years, studying the Bible year after year, never making a real dedication in their hearts, never making the truth their own. So if you want to survive the coming destruction, you've got to be inside the ark. We've got to be inside the ark. We can't just build it. Because imagine what we would think after the Great Tribulation if we are not inside the congregation. The May 15th, 2006 Watchtower tells us, are you prepared for survival? It says, are we actually inside Jehovah's arrangement of spiritual protection? When the Great Tribulation strikes, tears of joy and thankfulness will stream down the faces of those who have sought such protection. For others, there will only be tears of sorrow and regret. May that not be any one of us. In fact, if you look at Proverbs, the very first chapter of Proverbs. After the Great Tribulation strikes, those on the outside of the congregation have a pronouncement directly from Jehovah. And this is what he will say. Proverbs chapter 1, starting in verse 24. Because I have called out, but you keep refusing. I have stretched out my hand, but there is no one paying attention. And you keep neglecting all my counsel, and my reproof you have not accepted. I also, for my part, shall laugh at your own disaster. I shall mock when what you dread comes. When what you dread comes just like a storm, and your own disaster gets here just like a storm wind, when distress and a hard times come upon you. At that time you will keep calling me, but I shall not answer. They will keep looking for me, but they will not find me. For the reason that they hated knowledge and the fear of Jehovah, they did not choose. They did not consent to my counsel. They disrespected all my reproof. Verse 32. For the renegating of the inexperienced ones is what will kill them. And the easygoingness of the stupid is what will destroy them. That's how we will feel if we are outside Jehovah's ark, the modern day ark of his congregation. So Jehovah puts a choice in front of each of us today. In fact, he gives us that choice at Deuteronomy chapter 30 and verse 19 in our final scripture. Notice what that choice is. It's Deuteronomy chapter 30 and verse 19. Jehovah says, I do take the heavens and the earth as witnesses against you today, that I have put life and death before you, the blessing and the malediction, and you must choose life in order that you may keep alive you and your offspring. Jehovah says, choose life. Choose to live. Get inside the congregation. Qualify for salvation. Remember, Jehovah has done so much for us to gain our trust. The ark door is still open. If we're outside, Jehovah is inviting each and every one of us. Come on in.
Thank you, Brother Hendricks. Appreciate that encouraging public talk. Look forward to a closing talk after our abbreviated Watchtower discussion. One thing to note,